As I'm trying to see how it'd be possible to work with Dr. King's philosophy of non-violence, you see.
Well, see, now, non-violence with Dr. King is only a method. That's not his objective.
No, it's not his objective.
Well, his objective, I think, is to gain respect for Negroes as human beings. And non-violence is his method. Well, my objective is the same as King's. Now, we may disagree on methods, but we don't have to argue all day on methods. Forget the methods or the differences in methods. As long as we agree that the thing that the Afro-American wants and needs is recognition and respect as a human being.
Would you a change in evaluation of the black Muslim movement in America, have you changed your view about separatism, political separatism, the actual formation of an independent state of some kind?
Well, I might say this, that the problem of the solution for the Afro-American is twofold, long range and short range. I believe that a psychological, cultural, and philosophical migration back to Africa will solve our problem. Not a physical migration, but a cultural, psychological, philosophical migration back to Africa, which means that restoring our common bond will give us the spiritual strength and the incentive to strengthen our political and social an economic position right here in America, and to fight for the things that are ours by right here on this continent. And at the same time, this will also tend to give incentive to many of our people then to want to also visit and even migrate physically back to Africa. And those who stay here can help those who go back, and those who go back can help those who stay here. In the same way that when Jews go to Israel, the Jews in America help those in Israel, and the Jews in Israel help those in America.
That's the long range. The second thing is your long range solution. Is that it?
Sir?
The second thing is the long range solution. So there are two aspects of solution. One is the short range.
Yes, the short range involves the long range. Immediate steps have to be taken to re-educate our people into the a more real view of political, economic, and social conditions in this country, and our ability in a self-improvement program to gain control politically over every community in which we predominate, and also over the economy of that same community. As here in Harlem, instead of all the stores in Harlem being owned by white people, they should be owned and operated by black people. The same as in a German neighborhood, the stores are run by Germans, and in a Chinese neighborhood, they're run by Chinese. In the Negro neighborhood, the businesses should be owned and operated by Negroes, and thereby they would be employing, and they would be creating employment for Negroes.
That you are thinking then of these, you might say, localities as being then operated by Negroes, not in terms of a set of a political state, a separate nation.
No. The separating a section of America for Afro-Americans is similar to expecting a heaven in the sky somewhere after you die.
It's not practical, then.
To say it is not practical, one has to also admit that integration is not practical.
I don't quite follow that.
In stating that the idea of a separate state is not practical, I'm also stating that the idea of integration forced integration, as they've been making an effort to do in this country for the past 10 years, is also just as impractical.
But both these poles, these two opposite,
both are impractical. Yes, both of them are impractical.
You then envisage Negro sections, the Negro communities, which are self-determining.
Yes, until a re-education program is devised to bring our people to the intellectual, economic, political, and social level wherein we can control, own, operate our own communities economically, politically, socially, and otherwise, well, any solution that doesn't involve that is not even a solution. Because if I can't run my neighborhood, you won't want me in your neighborhood.
You are saying, in other words, you see neighborhoods and communities that are all Afro-American and self-determining, but these are part of a larger political unity in the United States.
Because once the black man becomes the political master of his own community, it means that the politicians of that community will also be black, which also means that he then will be sending black representation or representatives not only to represent him at the local level and at the state level, but even at the federal level. All throughout the South, in areas where the black man predominates, he would have black representatives in Washington, D.C. Well, my contention is that the political system of this country is so designed criminally to prevent this, that if the black man even started in that direction, which is a mature step, and it's the only way to really solve his problem and to prove that he's the intellectual equal of others, why, the racists and the segregationists would fight that harder than they're fighting the present efforts to integrate.
They'll fight it, yes. Let me ask you two questions around this. One, there are Negroes now holding prominent place in the federal level.
They've been placed.
Dr. Weaver and
I don't mean those kind of Negroes who are placed in big jobs as window dressing. I refer to a Negro politician as a Negro who is selected by Negroes, who is backed by Negroes. Most of those Negroes have been given those jobs by the white political machine, and they serve no other function other than to as window dressing.
Ralph Bunch, too.
Any Negro who occupies a position that was given to him by the white man, if you analyze his function never enables him to really take a firm, uncompromising, militant stand on problems that confront our people. He opened up his mouth only to the degree that the political atmosphere at the time will allow him to do so without rocking the boat too much.
Is your organization supporting the voter registration drive in Mississippi this summer?
Yes, we're going to give active support to voter registration drives, not only in Mississippi, but in New York City. I just can't see where Mississippi is that much different from New York City. Maybe in method.
I don't either.
No, I don't see. I never will let anyone maneuver me into making a distinction between the Mississippi form of discrimination and the New York City form of discrimination. It's both discrimination. It's all discrimination.
Are you actually putting workers in Mississippi this summer?
We will. They won't be nonviolent workers.
Nonviolent in which sense? Upon attack? Or
we will never send a Negro anywhere and tell him to be nonviolent.
If he's shot at, shoot back.
If he's shot at, shoot back.